स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज़ द सेकेंड पार्ट ऑफ योर थर्ड चैप्टर ऑफ साइंस, दैट इज़ योर मटीरियल्स अराउंड अस. सो सेवेंथ क्लास, थर्ड चैप्टर ऑफ साइंस. सो लेट अस कंटिन्यू विद आर सेकेंड टॉपिक. अर्लियर वी हैव डन योर वूल, हाउ द वूल इज एक्सट्रैक्टेड फ्राम शीप्स. नाउ सेकेंड इज योर सिल्क. सो सिल्क इज ड्रॉन फ्राम, इज ड्राइड फ्राम योर सिल्क वॉर्म. And let me show you the picture of real picture of silkworm. So this is your silkworm, and its scientific name is Bombyx mori. So Bombyx mori is very cute, as you can see from the picture also. So this is the real silkworm, which is used for extracting silk or silk threads, or for then further for making silk fabrics and saris and all those things. So let us start studying about silk now. So silk fibers are dried from silkworms, as I have shown you the picture of that silkworm. And therefore this is animal fiber. So silk is animal fiber because we are extracting the silk from a worm. So this is an animal source. Then silk is produced by a moth, known as silk moth. Moth means to say any insect or species. So silk is, you can say, extracted from silkworm. The scientific name for the silk moths or for the silkworm is Bombyx mori. This is very important. Learn it, that the scientific name of silkworm is Bombyx mori. So it is one of the most beautiful moths ever found, as you can see from that picture also. So very cute and very beautiful moth. So the breeding and the management of silkworms for the production of silk is called sericulture. This definition is very important. So what is sericulture? Sericulture means to say the breeding and the management of silkworms for the production of silk. So next, let us discuss about the life cycle of silk moth, how that moth is, you can say, given birth, and then how they produce silk, and finally what kind of position they got at the end. So about the whole life cycle, we are starting from the mating of female and male counterparts of those silkworms, you can see. So the female species of silk moth is shorter and shorter than male counterpart. It attracts the male counterpart by secreting hormones. Hormones means to say certain kind of chemicals. So the female, you can say, insect secretes certain kind of hormones to attract the male counterpart. Then mating takes place, and then the female species of silk moth lay eggs on leaves. Then she lays eggs on the leaves. After about 20 days, egg hatches into larva. So after hatches means to say break up, you can say, and larva come out from that egg after 20 days. Once the female, you can say, earthworm lays the eggs, after 20 days from those eggs larva come out. Larva is a small insect, you can say, and these hatched larvas are called silkworms or caterpillars. So these are the small silkworms or caterpillars, you can say. And then the silkworm are continuously fed on finely chopped mulberry leaves for about 6 weeks. Then they are allowed to feed on mulberry leaves. What is mulberry? Mulberry, that is called shahtoot or tooth in Punjabi. So they are fed on those leaves, shahtoot tree, on the leaves of a shahtoot tree, that is mulberry leaves. And then for about 6 weeks, they keep on feeding on those leaves. During this period, they grow in size, and their glands that produce silk develop and attain 1/3 of the size of larva. So what happened during this period? They grow and they start growing. First, let me show you the figures. First, they have shown you the, you can say, mature moth, which lays egg. Female moth which lays egg. Then eggs develop into larva. And then that larva start developing by eating those, you can say, mulberry leaves. The larva keeps on growing day by day, and they develop an organ in their body which is responsible for the production of silk. Soon after eating, after the time, as the time passes, they develop an organ which is responsible for the production of silk. And at this stage, silkworm is ready to enter the next stage of life called pupa. So first is your larva, then you can say caterpillar or larva, then caterpillar, and then pupa. So now the third state, at the third stage of life, that is pupa, he is able, or the silkworm is able, to secrete that thread or secrete that silk. Then pupa holds itself by weaving a net around its body by swinging its head from side to side in the form of eight. So as you can imagine, like the structure of eight number of mathematics. So he keeps on weaving his thread or his silk thread like this, and that silk thread keeps on revolving itself from head one side to another side, you can say. So making the shape of eight, he keeps on doing this, and the silk thread keeps on coming out of his mouth. In this way, that pupa, you can say, excrete the silk thread and wrap it around itself. And then what happens then? While swinging the head in this manner, the silkworm secretes the wet sticky substance. So this substance is made up of protein. Basically, they are talking about that silk thread now. So basically, that silk thread is made up of proteins which hardens on exposure to air and becomes silk fiber. So when that you can say liquid material is exposed to air, to normal atmosphere, that become thick in nature, and that final silk fiber comes out. Soon the silkworm is completely covered with silk fiber, and this covering is known as cocoon. So now this yellow colored thing that is shown in fourth figure at the fourth stage, this is cocoon now. What is this actually? The pupa, it has wrapped itself in the silk thread that is produced by the pupa itself. So this is cocoon, and the whole yellow color, this is shown in figure, this is your silk thread. And then a cocoon is spun by using two long continuous fibers from the two glands. Finally, the two ends of the fibers are joined by using sticky substance, that is sericin. So sericin is another kind of chemical or substance that is released by that pupa to end that release of that thread, silk thread. The silkworm continues to develop inside the cocoon. Now what is happening inside the cocoon? Because earlier that was a, you can say, larva, then caterpillar, or you can say caterpillar, then they have developed into pupa. So inside, he is going to grow more and more, or he or she, that is your female, you can say silkworm, that keeps on growing, and outside they keeps on making that silk thread. So inside cocoon, he is present and he is growing. So once the cocoon are spun, the pupa turns into adult moth. So once that cocoon is, you can say, complete, they turn into adult moth, means to say they are now capable to give birth to their younger ones. They grow to that stage at which they can give birth to more similar kind of silkworms. So at that stage they are able to give birth. Adult means to say, adult moth means to say, they develop into that stage where they can give birth to their younger ones. They can give birth to more silkworms. So after the complete development of silkworm, the cocoons are gathered and kept under the sun, or boiled, or exposed to steam. So after once people who are taking care of all these things, they know that after these much days they have developed, and they remove that cocoon and they keep that cocoon for boiling, or for, you can say, for extracting silk from that. And boiling releases the silk fiber from the cocoon. After boiling, they get that silk fiber from that cocoon. The silk fiber from many cocoons are brought together to form a single silken thread. And you know, many cocoons are you can say brought in together, then they will be able to make that single silken thread. So this process is called reeling of silks. This the whole process by which the, you can say, silk is produced is called reeling of the silk. And reeling is done in special machines which unwind the fibers of the silk from the cocoon. So basically, what are they doing? The end process, that is, you can say, extraction of the silk from cocoons. So that is called your reeling of silk, and that is done by specialized machines. So this is all about here. They have shown you reeling. These are the cocoons, white colored egg like shaped structures that I have shown. They have shown you in this figure 3.9. So these are cocoons basically, and from these cocoons they actually produce the silk. They finally get the product, and product that is your silk. So now they have classified the silk into three categories broadly. Three grades of silk are obtained from the cocoon. The unwound fiber from the finest quality of silk is called reeled silk. Now they have divided the silk into three categories on the basis of their quality. The silk which is very fine, very fine texture, that is called your reeled silk. It is pure white in color. Okay, then silk that remains after reeling process from the damaged or waste cocoon is carded or combed. So what is carded now? Carded means to say removal of wrinkles or any kind of, you can say, curls from there to make that thing straightened. So if there is anything remained after, you can say, after reeling process, the, you can say, damaged cocoons, they again them combed them or carded them and then make them straight, and that silk is called your somewhat little quality, or you can say of inferior quality, so that is called your spun silk. Then comes the third category. So what is the color of this spun silk now? Reeled silk is of, you can say, pure white color. This spun silk is, you can say, honey colored, little bit golden in shade. And then after that, the carding or combing, the short fibers which are left behind constitute an even inferior quality of silk called nail silk. And it is richly textured or rough silk. This is rough, the third category is, you can say, of a poor quality, and it is a rough silk and it is left behind after getting the finest quality silk, that is reeled silk, and then second is your spun silk. So this is all about your three kinds of silk. Now next is, sometime 3-4 silk fibers are twisted into a strand for weaving to prevent silk yarn from splitting into individual fiber. This process is called throwing. As you can imagine, may have seen a thread, they are very thin in nature. So to make them strong, or to, you can say, get the desirable quality in that silk thread, they weave 2-3 single threads to make one single thread. So that is called your throwing. That is particularly done to, you can say, to prevent the, you can say, breakage of that thread. So, or splitting of that thread. To prevent the splitting of that thread, they weave 2-3 threads together, and this process is called throwing. Then comes your silk fiber is mainly made up of two proteins, that is your sericins and fibrin. And these are two proteins. They may ask you a question, what kind of proteins are present in silk fiber? So these are the two proteins that are present in silk fiber. Then it is soft and elastic. Soft and elastic. Elastic means to say which is stretchable, which the thing that we can stretch, and after releasing the force, they get their original position. They can be compressed or stretched. So that is called elastic. So silks are basically soft and elastic, shiny and lustrous. Luster means to say bright in nature. So they are having shine and luster. It is a very strong fiber. It is a very strong fiber actually. So do you know that the soft silk yarn is as strong as of this comparable thread of steel? So they are not easily breakable. They are very strong actually. Their strength can be compared to silk thread of the similar, you can say, similar size or shape. So then silk fiber do not conduct heat. They do not conduct heat means they do not get heated up in the hot environment. They are not good. They are good insulators also, because they do not conduct electricity. Insulators means to say. Then comes your silk cloth keep you warm in winter and cool in summer. Why? Because they are bad conductors of you can say heat. That is why in summer they stay at the normal temperature. In winters also they stay at the normal temperature. They do not get, you can say, lower temperature because of the atmospheric temperature. Means atmospheric temperature does not affect the silk clothes. So they retain their normal temperature. That is why they keep you warm in winters or keep you cool in summers, because they're bad conductors of heat. So silk cloth can be dyed or before or after weaving. So after the silk thread is obtained, they can weave the thread and then they can dye. Dye means to say they color that particular silk before weaving. They can color that thread and then weave, or firstly they can weave and after that they can color that or dye that in different desirable colors. So silk is the queen of the fibers. There is no doubt that silk is a queen of fibers. And silk is the cloth of silk is considered very fine, and you can say it is closely also. So it is used for making saris, dress materials, jackets, carpets, so scarves and gloves, etc. So then the varieties of silk that we are getting from market, they have given those your crepe, chanderi, organza, mulberry, ari, then tersar silk and muga and kosa are the few varieties of silk. Let us perform an activity using these silks or the fabrics of these silks. So in the picture below, they have given you, first one is your mulberry silk, then it's your Chanderi silk, and then is your organza silk and tussar silk. So what kind of activity you have to perform? You have to observe the burning characteristics of various kind of fibers. So if you are having these fibers at your home, you can check the burning, you can say, characteristics of these fibers. So what you have to do, let us check from the next page. In this activity, what you have to do, you have to collect first of all different kinds of clothes, for example your cotton cloth, then your nylon piece, means you can consider any rope etc for nylon, and then your silk cloth, and then any woolen cloth or a piece of wool. What you have to do here, you have to burn these different things, and you have to observe the flame and the residue left behind. So one by one you have to burn, but please be careful while doing this experiment. So what you will do, when you will burn the cotton, it will burn steadily, and the light smoke is, you can say, originate from that burning, and it burns like a paper, and after that there is ash left behind, and fine ash is left behind that can be crumbled on touching. So then comes your nylon. Nylon, you can take any nylon rope, and when you heat that rope or when you burn that rope, it start melting. It shrinks after some time, and then a few drops of nylon keeps on dropping on the ground, and because it start melting before burning. So it start melting up when you start heating the nylon rope, and at the end what you are left behind, you are having hard beads which can be molded when they are hot and cannot be molded when they are cold. So because they are plastic, they are thermosetting plastic, so that is why. Then comes your silk. Silk burns very slowly because they are, you can say, fire extinguisher. So they burns very slowly, and at the end you are left with silver beads which can be crushed easily to powder. And in case of wool, wool also burns slowly and stops burning if you remove that from the flame. So at the end what you left with brown colored, you can say, beads that can be crushed easily by pressing. So this is about this activity. And then you have given a few question, very you can say, very easy question, scientific name that I have already told you, Bombyx mori, which is very important, and inferior quality of silk, that is your spun silk, and then comes your most inferior is your nail silk, and then what is sericulture, the rearing of, you can say, the production of silk from the silkworm is called sericulture. Then what is the food for silkworm, what is the food, mulberry leaves. So this is all about your chapter. I hope you have understood it well. So thanks for listening. Have a nice day.